Hello and good morning, everyone. Rainy morning here in Vancouver, and welcome to our popular web show, It's All in Your Head with Dr. Paul Swingle. My name is Rita. I will be the moderator of the show, and today we have a topic that relates to many people, not only in North America, but worldwide. Dr. Swingle will be talking about depression. Before I bring Dr. Swingle in, let me tell you a little bit about his impressive background. Dr. Swingle was titular full professor of psychology at the University of Ottawa prior to moving to Vancouver. Fellow of the Canadian Psychological Association, Dr. Swingle was lecturer in psychiatry at Harvard Medical School, attending psychologist at McLean's Hospital in Boston, where he also was coordinator of the Clinical Psychophysiology Service. Dr. Swingle is a registered psychologist in British Columbia, certified in biofeedback and neurotherapy. His newest book, Biofeedback for the Brain, was published by Rutgers University Press. The book is available at www.soundhealthproducts.com. Again, that is www.soundhealthproducts.com. One more thing I'd like to say is that we will have three breaks during this show in which we'll be answering your questions. You can submit your questions by typing them into the chat box located on the control panel that you can see on your screen. Just click on the chat tab, type your question in the chat box, click the send button, and that's all you need to do. And now, without further ado, here is Dr. Swingle. Good morning.
Everything. There we go. Okay. Good morning, folks. As Rita was saying, our topic today is depression. And as I assume everybody knows, depression is the major disabler in North America, at least, and certainly probably around the world. In terms of major depression, we're dealing with a lifetime frequency of something about 16 to 18%, and any particular 12-month period, we're in the roughly 7% range of the population of age 5 and over. So we're going to be going over a lot of the neurological issues associated with depression. And we'll be talking about pediatric depression, a lot of conditions that are diagnosed as depression and don't respond very well to antidepressants. Okay, so let's get started. And the factors associated with depression, first genetics, and we're going to be talking about neurological conditions that are predispositions to depressed mood states. And when we do full brain assessments, that is, when we look at the brainwave activity of individuals, we can see if they have markers for predisposition to depressed mood states. That doesn't necessarily mean they're depressed at the moment, but it means that they have a lower threshold for falling into that condition. That's something that's been recognized for hundreds of years. The early psychologists, James and so forth, point out that some individuals just have a propensity for looking at the world through negative lenses. And basically what they were talking about are genetic predispositions. The second is experience. If somebody dies, you're going to feel a grief and mourning and so forth. And one of the issues that we're going to be talking a lot about is you can see the neurological markers for what's called reactive depression. And one of the big mistakes we make is medicating reactive depression. If somebody dies, you're supposed to experience grief and depressed mood states, and you work through all of that and come out the other side. If you medicate that, then you never actually deal efficiently with that state, and it's quite a normal state. There's nothing abnormal about it. Third, trauma, and we'll be talking a lot about that. When individuals experience these severe emotional stressors, then the brain very often will show us a marker for that. And individuals who have experienced severe traumatic experiences have a unique kind of brain architecture that's associated, again, with depressed mood states. That's a little different than genetically based depression. Anxiety is a major contributor to conditions that are diagnosed as depression, and these are conditions that don't respond well to antidepressive medications. And we'll go over why that is. And then we have general, what I call dis-ease, and that is individuals who are in pain or they are in a lot of body discomfort, severe sleep disturbances, things of that nature. They just don't feel well. And often that's diagnosed as a depressed mood states and put on antidepressants, and sometimes they help a bit. When I was at McLean Hospital, the psychopharmacologists would often give antidepressants for people in severe pain because it reduced the stress associated with the pain, I guess is the best way of articulating that. Okay, let's get started. One of the features associated with some forms of therapy is that folks don't feel it's very efficacious. I was just chatting with Rita before we went on air that I was looking in at depression on one of the medical news feeds, and it said that the risk of suicide increases at higher altitudes, and I was reminded of this cartoon. Now, what you're looking at here is raw data. These are numbers that are taken from brain activity of an individual who came in with a diagnosis of depression and sleep disturbance. Now, what I want to point out here is we're going to be going over data, and it's going to be quite technical, so that you can get an understanding of how we approach the treatment of depression by taking care of the neurological conditions that are associated with predisposition to these states. Now, what you're looking at here is these two numbers. One of them is from the right side front part of the brain, and the other is from the left front side of the brain. And you notice there's a disparity here. The disparity is about 50%. Now, F3 is the left frontal part of the brain. F4 is the right frontal part of the brain. And this is beta. These are brain waves from 16 to 25 cycles a second, fast waves in the brain. And you'll notice that and this is theta, this is balance, this is alpha, this is balance, but beta is out of balance here. That's a marker, the classic marker for genetic predisposition to depressed mood states. And here it is here, that disparity there in percentages is about 58%. And this is a second client who has another condition associated with depression. Now, we see the disparity that I was just talking about here. Here it's about 30%, but there's another major disparity here between the right and the left, and that's in theta amplitude, and that's about 75%. Now, this is a different form of depression in a sense that this individual has major mood swings and major emotional volatility. So there's depressed mood state and emotional volatility. And here it is here. Remember the last one, we had the disparity in beta, but now we have a disparity in theta as well. So we have a condition here of predisposition to depressed mood states and predisposition to emotional volatility. So this person looks a little different to the clinician when they are coming in with these diagnoses of depressed mood states. Okay, now, this is the right side of the brain, and there's the left side. I'm talking about the frontal cortex. Now, here's the back of the brain. This is the frontal part of the brain. Now, depression, the classic marker for depression, that is a genetic predisposition to depressed mood states, is that this area of the brain is more active than this area of the brain. There's your classic brainwave signature for genetic predisposition to depressed mood states. We're going to be talking about all of these other areas of the brain as they are implicated in depression. Now, you'll notice, and if you remember the second case that I put up on the screen, theta, which is a slow wave, was markedly greater in this area of the brain relative to that, and that is your marker for emotional volatility. So although these people both came in with a diagnosis of depression, they look very different. One is the very despondent, quiet individual. The other is the one that is crying a lot of emotional volatility associated with their presentation of a depressed mood state.
Thank you, Dr. Swingle. This is our first break, and I would like to take this opportunity to say that if you are not on our mailing list, but you would like to be, you can go to our website at www.swingleandassociates.com and sign up for our newsletter on the homepage. We send newsletters once a month, and we keep you informed about all the new events. We are receiving lots of questions, so let's get started right away. Dr. Swingle, in my circle of female friends, all but three are taking antidepressants. I don't take any myself. Is my group unusual?
Yeah, it's interesting. And somebody just mentioned that to me a couple of days ago, that she felt that and all of her friends, or at least a lot of her friends, were on antidepressants. And it was kind of, very public. Thing. What prompted this woman to mention this to me was one of her friends had a seizure, and apparently she had come off an antidepressant very rapidly, and there is a risk of seizure associated with that. In any event, the comment she made was that so many of her friends were on antidepressants. What we're finding is a lot of individuals just don't want to feel badly, and they're taking antidepressants, I think, as mood elevators. That is, they just don't, they want to feel happier, they want to feel content, they don't want to go through any negative mood states. The problem with that is it narrows your window of emotional reaction, so you're kind of living in a more narrow emotional state. I think your group probably is unusual in terms of the number of people that are on antidepressants, but what I'm observing is that more and more people are taking antidepressants for more trivial reasons. That is, they're not dealing with depressed mood state. They're dealing with a situation in which, I guess the best metaphor is popping happy pills.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Swingle. Another question. What does Prozac do? Does it raise alpha all over brain, therefore maybe masking trauma markers?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. And I have not noticed I guess I have to backtrack from that. Given that what I'm looking at are all our clinical populations, I think what alpha may do with it, I'm sorry, what the Prozac may do if it's increasing alpha is mask a trauma marker, except if the individual has a lot of experience in looking at the trauma waveforms, because even if you have somebody with native, very robust alpha, like a visual artist, for example, you can see trauma on top of that because the waveform has a peculiar look. Actually, later on in the talk, I'm actually going to show you what trauma looks like when we're measuring brain activity.
Okay, and we'll take one more question. I have heard that doctors are giving antidepressants to help with pain. Does depression make pain worse?
Yes. That's what I was mentioning earlier, actually. When I was at McLean Hospital, a lot of the psychopharmacologists would prescribe antidepressants for folks who had severe pain conditions. And I think it reduces the distress associated with the pain rather than the actual subjective amplitude or severity of the pain. Same is true with tinnitus, by the way. It's interesting that tinnitus is ringing and buzzing in your ears. It's interesting that the stress is not correlated with subjective amplitude of the sound. So I suppose there is a rationale for trying to decrease the distress of an individual and therefore their perception and ill at ease factor associated with pain would be reduced with an antidepressant.
Thank you.
Okay, severe depression. Again, what we find are the markers that I've indicated already. Here we have this profound imbalance in beta, and we also have the elevated slow frequency, or theta, in the left side relative to the right. So both of those are indicators of the right side of the brain being more active than the left. Now, the reason I'm showing you this particular case is this down here. And this is the ratio of slow to fast alpha. And what this is a marker for brain efficiency. Alpha are brain waves that go from 8 to 12 cycles a second, and we want to have more fast alpha. That is, the strength of alpha in the 10 to 12 range should be stronger than the ratio, than the amplitude of the slow alpha. Now, anything below about 1.5 is okay. We want it closer to 1. Now, when it gets up in this region, this is one of the side effects of antidepressant and sedating medications. It slows down alpha, which, of course, is why it works. It's slowing down brain activity. But the side effect associated with that is reduced the cognitive efficiency. And the longer you take medications and the more of them that you take, the greater the impact on brain efficiency. Pediatric depression. The critical element with pediatric depression is that one of the first manifestations or one of the first things that parents will notice is lack of interest. The typical stereotype we have of a teenage boy laying around on the couch, not interested in anything, that is probably an expression of depression. So you're very likely to see different kinds of behaviors as opposed to frank sadness, although we do have pediatric manifestations of depression in which poor mood state, the negative mood state, is quite apparent. Okay, now, this is a topographic map of an electroencephalograph. So these are the topographical representations of brain waves. We were talking about a situation in which the right side of the front part of the brain, here's the front part of the brain up here, your nose is right there, and where the front right side is more active than the left. Now, this is one of the ways that can happen because this is theta activity in the brain, very slow activity, 3 to 7 cycles a second. Now, when theta is high, it means that that area of the brain is hypoactive. So this area is being suppressed, so to speak, which means that this side is more active than that. Now, there's your one of your markers for predisposition to depressed mood states. We're going to be talking about anxiety, and here is the classic marker for anxiety. And this is very fast frequency activity, 15 to 30 cycles a second. And you can see it's very hot here. Now, when you have a situation in which there's not enough slow activity relative to fast activity in the back of the brain, that's a marker for predisposition to anxiety conditions, poor stress tolerance, genetic marker for alcoholism, poor sleep quality, and so forth. Now, this is what we would, in the old days, would refer to as agitated depression. Okay. What about antidepressants? I love this cartoon. Came out of the New Yorker. One of the things that we're finding, and this goes back to a question that that was asked earlier on about a situation in which a woman found that her peer group, her group of friends, virtually everybody was on antidepressants. You can see that for other than serious, really serious depression, the placebo effect of an antidepressant is 82%. Okay. So what this is saying, and by the way, these are not active placebos. These are not active placebo pills. And what we mean by an active is that there's an ingredient in it that the person can recognize that they're taking something. But in a non-active placebo, 82% of it is attributable to placebo. So a lot of the folks that are taking these happy pills, as it says down here, it's basically expensive Tic Tacs. And this is the concept we have of the use of antidepressants in that sense, and that is, you know, just to keep a person on a high. They don't work that way, but that's the kind of sentiment and notion that we have about it. Okay, summary of what we've talked about so far. If you have a situation in which the slow frequencies are greater in the left relative to the right, it means that the right is more active than the left. So those are markers for depression. Situation in which the fast frequencies are greater in the right than the left, of course. That's the first case that we looked at. Again, that means that the right's more active than the left. There's your marker for depression. Now, we're also going to be talking about anxiety-based depression. So, when it's the brain is more active than that, that's your marker for depression. And there are subtleties associated with those differences. Some are associated with genetic markers. Some are associated with experiential markers. That is, something negative has happened to the person, and they become depressed because of that. Okay, anxiety-based depression. Recall that what I was showing you in the topographical map showed a hot spot in the back of the brain where there was elevated fast frequency in the back of the brain. And what that, how that shows up is in the ratio of slow, the amplitude of slow to fast activity, theta-beta ratio as it's called. And we want that ratio to be in the range of 1.8 to 2.2. In other words, we want to have twice as much theta amplitude, that is, the theta amplitude should be twice that of what the beta amplitude is in the back of the brain. So here's your classic marker for severe anxiety, predisposition to anxiety, poor stress tolerance, predisposition to self-medicating behavior. And these are burnout, worn-out forms of depression. Very often the person is not presenting with frank sadness, the tearful kind of stereotype we have of depression, but this is a person who's just at the end of their tether. They're worn out, and they present as depressed. The problem with this is that it does not respond well to antidepressant medications. Here's a situation of a 50-year-old male. He comes in and he says he has a long history of depression, 40 years, and unsuccessful psychotherapy and medication use, 30 years, okay? The reason is they are trying to use antidepressants for a condition that's associated with anxiety-based depression. Okay. Now, this is the brainwave spectrum measured at one spot in the brain. Okay. Now, this is what it should look like. These are the very slow frequencies down here, down around one cycle a second, up to 40 cycles a second. Now you'll notice it's the kind of distribution that we have here. The lower the frequency, the higher the amplitude. The higher the frequency, the lower the amplitude. So that we say amplitude should be inversely related to frequency. It should look like this, okay? And that's the kind of distribution that we should have. These are the raw signals associated with this. This is the basic raw signal of the EEG. This is pulling out the slow frequencies, and these are the faster frequencies, okay? So, this is your standard marker for anxiety in the front part of the brain. Now, we've been talking before about the back. Now, remember, the genetic marker for predisposition to depressed mood states is when the right, F4 is the right, is considerably more active than the left. Now, this is the other way around, in which the beta amplitude is 36% greater in the left relative to the right, and that's your an anxiety marker. Here's what sleep problem looks like. And what this is we're looking at beta now. Remember, this is 16 to 25 cycles a second, a very fast wave, and we're measuring it at the back of the brain. Okay? So here's eyes open, and you can see that amplitude here is 10 microvolts, okay? The person closes their eyes, and when they close their eyes, beta jumps markedly. In other words, the brain turns on when they close their eyes as opposed to turning off. There's your classic marker for sleep disturbance, okay? And this is what it looks like if you're looking at the raw signal. Now, if a person has a sleep disturbance, at some point they're going to get depressed. Now, what have we just been talking about with regard to anxiety? The hallmark feature of anxiety is marked deficiency of slow frequency relative to fast frequency in the back of the brain. And that is the ratio of the amplitude of the slow frequency relative to the fast is much less than 1.8. In the front part of the brain, the last one that I just showed you, in which the left side is considerably greater than the right in terms of the beta amplitude. We have a couple of other ways of measuring that as well. But basically, you're looking at marked elevation of the left relative to the right. We also have another area of the brain which can cause trouble as well. And if we have enough time, I'll review that as well. Okay, so what have we learned? Depression. The right's more active than the left. There are lots of ways that can happen. Anxiety. This area of the brain is not working efficiently in terms of self-quieting. And that is, there's more, too much fast activity in the back of the brain relative to the slow activity, and the brain lacks the capability for self-quieting. This is also associated with poor sleep quality, predisposition to anxiety, poor stress tolerance, self-medicating behavior like alcohol use, worn-out, burnout, fatigue, burnout forms of depression. Anxiety. This area is considerably more active than the left in terms of beta amplitude. I would bet you a quarter that what you're dealing with is what we were just talking about, and that is marked elevation of fast frequencies in the back of the brain. You can't find peace in your own head, and you can't find the switch to turn your brain off, and you are simply...
I am sorry, Dr. Svengel, can I just interrupt? I have some comments here. They couldn't hear my question. I think my microphone was muted by accident. So let me repeat the question first. I have been depressed for most of my life, at least as long as I can remember. Nothing seems to work. I'm on every antidepressant, and I'm a bit better for a while, then go back to where I was. Can your brain work help with this?
Okay, as I was saying, my guess is that the condition you have is the one we were just talking about, and that is a marked elevation of fast frequency relative to slow in the back of the brain, so that your brain lacks the capability for self-quieting. Antidepressants don't touch that, other than some placebo effect, which is probably what you're reporting. You feel a little better for a while, and then it goes right back to where you were. So the answer to your question is yes, neurotherapy is very effective in these kinds of conditions. And the reason that it's very effective is we look at the brain activity and determine what the cause of the problem is. The problem with top-down diagnostic procedures in which a client comes in and says, I'm depressed, and you know that I can't sleep and so forth. And then what the person will do, well, if you're depressed, I'll give you an antidepressant. We'll try that for a few weeks and see if that works for you. And it's kind of a hit and miss, as opposed to bottom up, in which you look to see what the brain is telling you in terms of what the actual condition is, and more importantly, where you go to fix it. So if you have a situation of one or two of those markers associated with elevated anxiety, it's the elevated anxiety that's causing the depression. And we would address that in terms of quieting.
Thank you. Next question. My husband says, I choose to be depressed. that I should just think better thoughts and do active things. He does not understand I cannot think better things. Can you help me?
And we run into this a lot, in which people are told that people are getting impatient and that you don't have to go around seeing the world as the glass half full. You can see the glass is half full rather than half empty. A lot of people are told, well, all you have to do is stop the negative thinking and think positive thoughts. And although that makes a lot of sense, the problem is they can't do it. And what neurotherapy helps with is to get some of these factors that are predisposing factors associated with low threshold for falling into depressed mood states to help you with regard to those genetic or neurological preconditions. Then other forms of therapy like cognitive behavior therapy, dialectical behavior therapy, EMDR, and so forth and so on become much more efficacious. So neurotherapy is combined with these other therapeutic techniques very, very frequently, and it's a very powerful combination. So my suggestion is to have a brain assessment and see what the predisposing factors are associated with this. And in one sense, your husband is right. You know, just think better thoughts. The problem is he has to understand that that's not something you're capable of doing simply because of these predisposing factors.
And we have time for one more question. What therapies would you use to quiet the brain apart from neurofeedback?
I'm sorry, I missed that question.
The question is, what therapies would you use to quiet the brain apart from neurofeedback?
Oh, quiet the brain. There are lots of things that you can do for brain quieting. The problem with meditation is if you have that marked elevation of fast frequency in the back of the brain that I showed you just earlier, the problem is you can't do mind-blank meditation. And when you try to do mind-blank meditation, you become extremely agitated, and you're worse after the episode, after the exercise than before. So there are some forms of active meditation that you can use for quieting. Then you have things like relaxation exercises, and these tend to be things like muscle relaxation exercises. We have a couple of products that we use with our clients, things like progressive muscle relaxation and cognitive guided imagery relaxation procedures. Then there are some devices that you can give yourself home treatments with for quieting, things like cranial electrical stimulators. These are devices that you attach to your earlobes and give yourself very low amperage electrical stimulation. They're FDA-approved devices for anxiety, depression, and sleep. So there are a lot of things that you can do at home in terms of helping with quieting. Okay, trauma. This is what a normal alpha response looks like. Now, what this is alpha, 8 to 12 cycles a second, and this is being measured right on top of the head. So this is an eyes open, and then I ask the person to close their eyes. Now, you'll notice a big jump in alpha when you close your eyes. This is exactly what should happen. Then when you open your eyes again, it should drop back. Here's the back of the brain, O1, back of the brain on the left side. Here's eyes open, eyes closed, a big jump in alpha. Then they open their eyes again, and it goes back. This is what trauma looks like. Eyes open, eyes closed. it not only doesn't go up, it went negative. Here's the back of the brain. Eyes open, eyes open, eyes closed. Where I discovered this was when I was at Harvard Medical School at McLean Hospital, working with combat veterans who were hospitalized for post-traumatic stress disorder. This is what they looked like. They didn't have any alpha response. Now, that makes infinitely good sense if you think about it, because alpha can be a visualization response, and the big issue associated with post-traumatic stress disorder are the flashbacks, the visual flashbacks, in which the person is right back in the situation. They are reliving the trauma. That's what a flashback is. Now, what this is there's a blunting of that in the brain to try to, if you want to think of it metaphorically, the brain's trying to protect itself against those flashbacks. So this is what it looks like. And if you look at a summary of that, here's the eyes open and the eyes closed, and this is the 15% reduction in alpha activity. Here's the back of the brain, and this is when the difference between eyes open and eyes closed. It's negative. Now, this should be above 30%. This should be above 50%. Okay? This person also has a depression marker. This is what a normal alpha response should look like. Now, this is eyes open. And here, again, remember, inversely related to amplitude. And then this person will close their eyes. There it is. There's your eyes closed. See? Nice jumping alpha. Nice and strong. And then they'll open their eyes. They'll drop like a stone. There it is. Okay. There's a normal alpha response. This is trauma. Now, it kind of looks like the alpha is trying to break through. It has that look to it. Very interesting. On the wall in my office, I have a 25-cent piece that's very, very elaborately framed in a gold leaf frame. And a lot of folks ask me what that quarter is, because it's just a United States 25-cent piece, and it doesn't have any value other than 25 cents, except it has very great sentimental value to me. Every once in a while, I bet my clients 25 cents. And this was a client who was hospitalized at McLean Hospital. He had suicidal depression, and he came in and he sat down and he said, "I'm a painter." And he had looked at a blank canvas for a couple of years, and he said, "I'll never paint again." Okay. And I bet him a quarter he would. His brain activity looked exactly like what I just showed you. Artists have extremely strong alpha responses. That is, when they close their eyes, alpha goes up very markedly, and that's the creative waveform. When you add trauma to that, it suppresses it, and it affects the creative waveform, so it affects their creativity. And they'll describe it that way. It feels like somebody's sitting on my creativity. Now, this person was diagnosed with depression. He was put on antidepressants and became more suicidal, which is, again, often associated with antidepressant use. But the problem here wasn't depression per se. Now, you could say that, well, he wasn't able to paint, so he had this problem associated with artistic block, and artists get very depressed when they have artistic block. So did he have reactive depression? And what it was that trauma emerged, and the trauma affected the alpha response, which affected the person's creativity, which meant that he stared at a blank canvas, which meant he got very depressed, which meant he got suicidal, and they gave him antidepressants, and it increased the suicidality. So that's the sequence. How do you treat this? You treat the trauma. And you can do this neurologically by releasing that alpha response. When you release the alpha response, you're going to have a traumatic reaction, an emotional reaction to this. And that's where the adjunctive therapies associated with neurotherapy become extremely important. Neurotherapy is not a standalone discipline. You need to have some capability for dealing with these kinds of things when they emerge. So we treated the trauma and got the trauma alpha response released. He came in, had my quarter framed, and gave me my quarter when he had the opening at a gallery. Okay. So this is what the trauma looks like right here. And now, if you look at this person, they have the trauma marker. They have a severe deficiency in the back of the brain. Remember, now that's where there's elevated fast activity relative to slow. So poor stress tolerance, predisposition to anxiety, self-medicating behavior, sleep quality problems. And they have the marker here for genetic marker for depression. Okay, what we have to do here is we have to release the trauma. We have to increase slow frequency in the back of the brain so the brain can heal and restore itself. And we have to balance the frontal cortex so that we're not feeding, we're dealing with the genetic predisposition to depressed mood states. We get an awful lot of kids coming in, diagnosed ADD and all kinds of crazy things, and it turns out that they're being bullied. You can sometimes see this on a brain map if you have a lot of experience of looking at these things. Now, we were just talking about trauma. Here's a 9-year-old child. Here is the percentage of eyes open versus eyes closed, alpha, the trauma marker we were just looking at. And he's showing a mild trauma marker right over the sensory motor cortex, right on top of the head. Not showing it in the back, but he is showing it here. Okay. And then we have a look at the front part of the brain. And what we're picking up here is a major elevation of alpha in the left relative to the right, and that is an experiential marker for depression. That is, individuals who have been exposed to negative events will very often show this marker, which is not a genetic marker now, it's an experiential marker. Something negative is happening to this person. So my best guess here is that we were dealing with a child who was being bullied. Now, and we're not seeing any issue here with ADD. Some of the ADD markers here are just not seeing it. We have mild things. We have mild elevation of slow frequency. We have a mild elevation of theta in the front. We have a mild elevation of alpha. All of these can affect concentration. But what's screaming at me here is the possibility that this kid is being bullied at school. Turns out that's exactly what was happening. So we can give central nervous system stimulants to this kid, all of the ADD medications, and it's not going to do anything except really make the situation bad. Okay, the summary of the trauma. Marked deficiency of the alpha response on top of the head and in the back of the brain. And frontally, we very often find that we have elevated alpha activity in the front part of the brain associated with this as well. Okay. We have poor alpha response here with eyes closed and a poor alpha response there.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Swingel. This is our last break and therefore the last opportunity to answer your questions. If you have any, this is the time to send them in. I apologize if we are not able to answer all of them, since we only have 1 hour for this webcast, but please feel free to email me the questions that we did not answer. Also, if you have any comments or suggestions about our webcast, please let us know. We would love to hear your opinion. Dr. Swingel, my brother's 10-year-old was diagnosed with depression. I think giving kids drugs for this is crazy. Do you think kids need a drug for this?
Well, and the first thing that we would want to do is we would want to do a brain assessment, see what we're dealing with. There are conditions in which medications can be very helpful, so let's not have a knee-jerk reaction against this. My experience is that it's very rare that we have to use an antidepressant medication on a child. There's usually a family situation going on, bullying going on, things of that nature. If they have a marker for predisposition to depressed mood states, they're usually brought in for a learning problem, not a depression problem. So the answer to your question is we have much, much better options in terms of treating pediatric depression than medicating.
Thank you. And another question, I get depressed every winter. I have tried the light boxes and they help a bit. Does brainwave therapy help with SAD?
Yeah, very decidedly. We find that folks with SAD, seasonal affective disorder, have predispositions to depressed mood state and their thresholds for falling into depression are lower. So yes, neurotherapy can help. And then there are other forms of light therapies that can be very helpful as opposed to the light box. We have glasses, for example, called Spectra, in which you put the glasses on and you're kind of walking around with your light box as opposed to having to sit in a room with it.
Thank you. Another question. I just want to clarify, left frontal elevated alpha is experiential depression marker?
Left frontal alpha elevated relative to the right. Yes, that's that is a marker for depression. That was one of the first ones discovered, by the way, and by Richard Davidson, Dr. Richard Davidson. He was the one that identified the discrepancy in alpha between the right and the left, and it was the first indicator of brain imbalance in the front associated with depressed mood states.
And one of our listeners would like to know, is OCD a predisposition or something that develops over time? Is this something I was born with?
There are markers for OCD, yes, and it's the anterior cingulate gyrus. If we have time, we only have a few minutes left, I'll show you what that looks like. But yes, that is a genetic predisposition. And it can manifest over time because it usually responds to stress.
Okay, and I'd like to conclude our question time with a comment that just came in from one of our listeners. I feel such a sense of overwhelming gratitude for the first time in my life. All the whys are being explained, tearing up. Thank you very much. That's a nice comment there. Okay.
Oh, thanks for the comment. Okay, trauma release. We have a lot of adjunctive therapies so that when you're trying to release the trauma, you don't have to only rely on neurotherapy. There are other things that we do. Experiential psychotherapy, hypnosis, the EMDR, which a lot of people have heard about, and somatoemotional release, which is a technique based on craniotherapy. The point that I'm making here is that you can release it with neurotherapy, or you can also release it with some other procedures, and you will find that the brain responds. And here's an example of that. Here we're looking at the ratio of slow to fast activity in the back of the brain. You remember we were talking about that. When the person came in, it was very, very low. After we did 15 treatments, we were able to bring it up to 1.5. And then we did a psychotherapeutic procedure based on cranial therapy. And when that trauma released and the individual dealt with the trauma, which happened to be multiple family sexual abuse, we got an immediate change in brain activity. So it's the point is it's synergic, bidirectional. You can do things psychotherapeutically and get a change in brain activity. You can change brain activity, and it will have an impact on the psychological factors. Okay, we only have a couple of minutes here. I wanted to show you a very aggressive treatment that we use for the treatment of some of these things. Most folks are familiar with brainwave biofeedback. We set it up so that when the brain's doing what we want it to do, the person hears a tone or sees something move on the screen, they make use of that information to learn how to self-regulate. We can get very aggressive with this. Here we have a situation in which we're presenting sounds, we're presenting lights, we're presenting electrical stimulation of acupuncture points, and it's all driven by the brain so that we drive the brain into more normal functional ranges. And this is me sticking needles in people when I was being trained at Shanghai. But this is an area on the hand in which if we're trying to drive up slow frequency in the back of the brain, when the slow frequency drops below a certain level, we stimulate this area to drive it back up. The procedure referred to as brain driving. And this is simply pointing out that the trauma, when we're trying to increase alpha during this brain driving, we increased alpha by 148%. And if we look at the alpha response, which is the trauma response again, before treatment, at the location in the back of the brain, it started, the alpha response was very slow, 8%, 10 seconds, and then 40% after 20 seconds, and we wanted above 50, which is the normal range, and it should happen almost instantly. After we did the brain driving, 10 seconds, twice as much alpha amplitude, and after 20 seconds, it's up in normal range. No. Okay, so trauma. Poor alpha response here, poor alpha response there. Okay, thank you very much for tuning in today. And for professionals, we have workshops associated with teaching how to do the brain assessments and some of the more aggressive treatments.
Well, I'd like to thank everyone for being with us today as well, and you can join us again next